Okay, that's cool. Oh yeah, we got this, like, easy. Oh, it's gonna let me keep going? I got the gold, though. Oh no, I don't need that. RIP stream. $26K. First try, not too shabby. Oh, got me an achievement. No flies on me. What's that one? Okay. Now, moving on to, this, oh, this is the snapshots or what? Bowser's Arcade has snapshots, but we're not gonna do that. We're gonna just play the game. Yeah. Ah, complete a snapshot. That's what that is. Cool. Stream went down. Is it back? And that happens from time to time. Stream dies when you're streaming off of Xbox. Not sure why. I don't know how far am I getting this. I'm gonna try to beat it, but I don't want to spend too much time on it. This is gonna probably be the last thing I do tonight, and then after that I'm gonna eat and go to sleep. Say tonight, shit, it's like 4:50 in the morning. Ooh, look at that. Looks like a lot of fun. Let's see, let's see these milestones. Mr. Koyan, play the game for the first time, yeah. Every stage is a game over time. Over time, beat the game with all three toads. Defeat 1,000 enemies with standard attacks and with smash attacks. Okay. That's easy. Basically, just play. Play the game is what it's saying. A, B, or X to select the toad. X for zits, A for rash, B for pimple. Well, since you play well, look at that. That looks freaking awesome. That was cool. X. I'm going with zits, because zits has kind of always been my favorite. Pimple's cool. Rash is cool, of course. Rash got the shades. It's kind of weird. It's hard to explain, right? Like, I've never played this arcade version, right? I mean, I guess I have a little bit, but I've never beat it. Never spent the time to beat it. Wasn't my Battletoads. My Battletoads was the one we just played. What I mean by that, you know, is like when I was young, stuff like that. But back to I guess why I favored Zitz. It's because he's like the one that, you know, is looked over a lot. Like, everybody likes Rash, right? And then everybody likes Pimple, because Pimple is like the brown one. Which technically, in the original game, Zitz is the brown one. And since it was kind of a secret, right? Like, back in the day. What? That was sick. Like, back in the day, nobody knew the game was two-player until, like, you had to try things, right? I hit start, like, oh, it worked, you know? Oh my gosh, it's two-player. You can join in. It's so cool. So, yeah, like, and then, like, this was the brown one, so I like that. And then, like, they palette changed them. They put Pimple as the brown one in this arcade. In Battle Maniacs, and Pimple's also the brown one in Battletoads Double Dragon. So, I mean, I like Zitz, because I've always been like a player 2 kind of guy, I guess. Because, like, whenever I had friends over, they always wanted to play first player, and you know, I've been like the nice guy and been like, all right, cool. It wasn't because I had a mean older brother or anything. Like, that's a lot of the player two kind of guy, like, you know, that's a lot of their stories is, oh, I got like a horrible older brother and I have to play player two. No, mine's more by choice because I was nice and I let my friends play player one because they wanted me. So, whatever. Whenever I used to have friends over and all that shit. That's so sick. Yeah. But yeah, so that's the story, right? Oh, I'm dead already. How do I continue? Okay, there we go. I guess I have to hit A to continue. That's weird, even though I already picked the... Like, what if I wanted to change to Rash or something, right? Like, I guess this is local three players, maybe? Damn tunnel, I died a million times. Yeah. Tunnel's legit hard as shit. I mean, I've done it, like, back in the day, whenever there was no internet, and when you were just playing on consoles at home and shit like that. Like, yeah, those days existed. For me, especially. Yeah, I played the shit out of Battletoads. Game Genie, no Game Genie, both ways. But obviously not good enough to, like, beat it, like that, you know? But I'm going to continue to play it and be able to beat it more, better. Because that's definitely a goal, is to be able to beat that game without, like, continues and shit like that. But, oh, it's the boss. Ha 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 ha. That's it? No way. That was so easy? Okay. That boy came back. So yeah, that's the story of why I like Blitz over Rash and Pimple. Pimple was actually number two. Rash was actually my third. It's because, like, Rash was cool and all, don't get me wrong, but he was Mr. Cool and everybody wanted to be Rash, so I was like always, oh, well, I'll be Zenitz or I'll be Pimple, you know, whatever. So that's my boy. Yo, what? That was sick. I figured out how to put a filter on. Yo, the filter looks clean too. Look at that. That was sick. Blitzed. Zitz, blitzed, thrashed. Rash thrashes and Pimple pulverizes. Zitz is the king of carnage. Yeah, those were the days, right? Like, I don't know what version to play it on now, like, with this or without it. Like, both of them look good to me. Like, the other one looks a little bit more crisp, I suppose, with the filter, right? But it's also blurry, and I don't like that. I don't like that it's blurry. Or actually, the word I was looking for wasn't crisp, it was smooth. It's more crisp like this. It's smoother with the filter, but it's also blurry. I don't necessarily like the blur. Nice. Saw that, that was it. You know, it's funny. Oh no, that's the other game. That's Battle Maniacs. The second level is also similar to the original Battletoads, where you're going down, except you're on a jetpack, or not a jetpack, you're on a hoverboard, going down. What is this? Oh, snap. Dear goodness. What am I supposed to do here? Was that three continues? I should keep count of how many continues I'm using. So we can tally up. Like, how many quarters I would use at the arcade. Yo, what? This boy came at me? Oh, snap. It's crazy. Moose. The moose. You know, I guess I never did play past the first level. Because I don't remember this. Oh, crap. That threw me off. Stop it! Fudge, man. Oh, I definitely don't remember that. A gun.
I got a gun, man. I had a gun in Battletoads.
Let's go. Gun's gone. Nice. Yes. No way back. Instead of no way back, it's no way back. That's tight. Yeah, if you saw that, wow, death. That move, yeah, that I just did. The double attack where you're attacking two people on two sides of you. That's where, Rash's air medium kick came from. It's not particularly this game. It's in Battle Maniacs. I think Rash does the kick, where when he's beating him up, he splits with the legs. He does it with the legs instead of arms. Zitz obviously does it with arms in this one. And I think Pimple does too. Does the arms. So that's kind of cool, right? Damn, man. This shit is eating my quarters. That's already at least a dollar. That's four continues. Or $2 if it's 50 cent play. Oh, let's go. What are we doing? Yo, these boys just jumping and doing shit. And I can't even dodge it. Oh, there we go. They still got me. Sometimes it was like that in arcades, man. Like, sections just ate your fucking quarters, and if you wanted to play, you kept on feeding the fucking machine. I'm all trying to be greedy, taking this fucking big-ass thing with me. Oh, dear. There's no way. This is a bad idea. Drop this thing. I need to drop this. Oh, fucking bullshit. Yeah, that shit made sure to eat a quarter. What's this? Continue number 5. Look at that. It was nice enough to put me right beside it. Fuck that. You can keep that. Hold that shit. That boy woke up and vomited. You saw that? Oh, now it wants to give me all the fucking flies after I already put my money in. And I can't reach that either. Couldn't dash it. Oh, I could reach that. Look at that. I was gonna say, is he just gonna leave? Alright. A little late now. How do I discard it? I can't. I don't think I can. I'll tight. I gotta exit though. Oh, fuck me.
tight. Oh snap.
Never played in arcades?
Yeah, well, I mean, for me, I had a local arcade, like, and it's just a way, like, for example, like, you know, when I was young, my mom, like, goes shopping and shit. Oh my goodness. This craziness. Look at this. Yeah, like, it's just, like, oh, she's at the mall shopping, like, going to the arcade, you know? Oh dear, I missed. Fuck, man. That's great. Ooh, that boy ate me. I'm gone. Ziz does not live anymore. He's out of there. But, yeah, like, while she was shopping, she gave me, like, $1 or $2. Like, if I was lucky, it would be, like, 5 or something. And then, but, yeah, most of the time I wasn't lucky. And then, like, it's like, here, go play what you want. So, you know. So you get, like, maybe 20 minutes in a local arcade full of video games, in which, I don't know, I don't know what malls had where you guys were from, but, like, and my arcade, my local arcade is actually still there. The bad thing is they took all the good games out. Like, it's like basically a kiddie attraction now. Like, I think the best games that are in there now is perhaps, they have a Need for Speed, like, racing simulator style game, kind of like San Francisco Rush or whatever, or Cruisin'. Except for it's not Cruisin' and it's not San Francisco Rush anymore. It's like the new one. So there's that. They have Pump It Up, which is like a DDR clone. Except for like the game itself is like it's got 5 steps instead of 4. It's like top left and right, bottom left right, and then 1 in the center. Instead of up, down, left, right, it's like the 4 corners instead, and then 1 in the center. So, yeah, that, and then I think there's Time Crisis 2 in there, or Time Crisis 3 still in there, and then like, so there's still some old school shit from back in the day, but it's mainly the kiddie attractions. Like, I think Big Bertha might still be in there, maybe the little Bozo little game in there. What else in that arcade? They got the skee ball game still, which I think is an updated version. I think I want to say they had an updated version of Rage in the Cage too. Man, I remember when Rage in the Cage came out in the arcade, man. Nobody would. Every motherfucker was like all over that game. Like nobody, like there was a line to play Rage in the Cage, which I don't know what that is. It's like a basketball, like arcade basketball game. Like, it was a legit thing that you wanted the high score in that game. But, usually my quarters went to Street Fighter or KI. Or Tekken. Tekken was actually kind of big in my arcade. Because Tekken had the custom cabinet, right? Like, there used to be a custom cabinet. Like, before they moved from the big spot that they were leasing in the mall, they moved, like, they used to have the big spot, right? Like, which was by the movies in the mall near my place. But before they moved, like, they moved around, like, the 2000s, and then, like, when they moved, all the fighting games were gone, NFL Blitz was gone. Actually, no, that's not true. They did move a couple things. And I think NFL Blitz was one of the ones they moved. No, they moved Showtime. I think they moved Showtime. They didn't move Blitz. No, they had Blitz in there for a little bit. They had Blitz and Showtime. It was a combo cabinet. At first, they had two separate cabinets. But then it was a combo cabinet. Combo cabinet. Shit, excuse me. I lost count of my continues, by the way. Telling this story. Because this story is better than, you know, than keeping count of how many continues I used. Y'all just don't fucking hit him in the nuts. Oh wow, that's fucking horrible. But yeah, man, it was just... Arcade was so legit back in the day, and now it's just like garbage. That's why I'm not like all hype about it. But it's a power play, by the way. I don't know what y'all have in y'all's malls. It actually had, there was actually a tilt, not in this mall, but like near my grandma's house was a tilt. So I kind of was in that arcade a little bit too when I was young. But, which in the tilt was even better because they had batting cages in that tilt. Like, it was a video baseball game. It's not really batting cages, like, it was a simulator. And there was like the special baseball bat they used, and that was legit. And then they also had a shooting range type of game. Like, my arcade didn't have all that shit. The Tekken scene was good there. Like, the Street Fighter scene was good. The KI scene was good. Like, it was like my dream arcade, which technically it's not a dream. It was real, but it's a dream now, cause it's dead now, because they took out all the fucking fighting games and made it kid-oriented and kid-friendly, and now nobody goes. Like, the arcade scene just straight died. There's a few people still left over, like me and shit, but, like, I have literally a handful of friends that I know used to go to that arcade that I still talk to, but, only one of which plays fighting games competitively still, and that's Splicer. But yeah, the only problem with that is like I never knew him when that arcade was like popular. Not until the Marvel 2 days anyway, which by that time it was kind of dying anyway. Shit happens. Which I don't even remember Marvel 2 technically being in my arcade. Like, I think Incident and Power Play, it was in the movie arcade, which I know it's still there. It's, the Marvel 2 is still in my movie arcade, and I think there's a copy of Tekken 5 in that arcade too. The movie arcade. But not as good as Power Play. Nowhere as good as Power Play was. Power Play was like the shit, and I'm telling you. Like, going inside Galloping Ghost in Chicago when I went to Combo Breaker, that's how Power Play was, except for, like, yeah, the Galloping Ghost is, like, hands down better, way better than Power Play ever was, but, like, most of the games that were ever in Power Play or are in Galloping Ghost, like Slam Masters, NBA Jam, Blitz, Showtime, the Turtles games, fucking, there's a game called, man, what's it called, fucking Lucky and Wild. That game is so silly, like, it's, yo, check that shit out. It's like he all walks, he's got a slow walking mechanic with this thing. But he can climb the fucking stairs. It's ridiculous. But anyway, there's a game called Lucky and Wild, right? One person drove while the other person like did the gun. There's like a machine gun mounted, and it was like a sit down cabinet. Like, you sat down in the cabinet. It was legit. Look it up if you're really that interested in it. It's a really good game. I mean, okay, like, looking back on it, like, oh yeah, like, it's not, like, that great of a game, but, like, I guess the nostalgia feel of it, and the fact that I remember playing it, like, that's a pretty good arcade game. Pretty decent. Yo, really? This dude was just taking a shit in there? Like, are you serious? Sorry, dude, you gotta go. this game right here, though. So yeah, arcade stories from back in the day. It was always fun beating all the little kids that always jumped on the cabinets and shit. Like, me being one of the better ones. Like, sometimes I'd lose to some of my friends, but like, when we played random little kids that just so happened to come in the arcade, man, it was on. And like, sometimes we lost. Like, we'd run against like kids that were actually good, and then beating all the older kids was cool too, until like that one older kid that was really fucking good, you know, ended up coming up, and then that would suck, because then your quarter was up. But yeah, I mean, arcade was fun. Like, I recommend anytime you can go to an arcade, just to go look at the machines. Like, the whole, you don't even have to play the game, like, the whole feel was so much better in the 90s than it is now. But, I mean, I like the fact that there are still some arcades out there that are trying to emulate that experience. That's pretty cool. Like Ultra, for instance, they try to emulate that experience from the 90s, even though there's console games now, too. Like, I mean, that's cool. Console and whatnot. So, like, mad respect to those guys. Brandon and fucking David and them. Yeah. Just for trying to keep that dream alive. And, what's the dude's name that owns Galloping Ghost? Doc. Yeah. That's legit. Like, man. I wish there was an arcade like the Ghost here. I would go as many times. I'd try my hardest to fucking work there. Like, because I know I couldn't fucking afford to be there all the time. But I would go whenever I could. Oh, damn. What the fuck was that? Oh, snap. That's crazy. Watch this. I can rewind it. That's sick. I just found that out. All I have to do is hit left trigger. I can rewind it to like an earlier part. Oh my gosh. Death. Not like it matters because it's like free play anyway. See, I could bring the other guy back if I kept on going. Okay, I need to stop doing that. Yo, why am I sitting here playing on controller? Oh, yeah, it probably won't. It won't let me play this game on stick. I already tried for KI Gold, that's right. That would be sick if I could emulate that, though. Look at that Dark Queen in the back, though. Oh shit. Yeah. Die out completely eventually. I don't know, man. There's a pretty big like maybe in public places, like you might see an arcade machine last for a while, like in a laundromat or some shit, you know, like. But I mean, it's not gonna have like a competitive scene or anything like that. Now, as far as tournaments go, I don't know, man. There's tournaments are a pretty big business. It's like a legit business now, you know, like esports and all that shit. The companies that make these games pour in a lot of money to tournaments so that way people will turn around and buy stuff and support their companies and investors and all that good stuff, you know? Like for instance, like KIT coming up in January, Mortal Kombat NetherRealm put $10,000 into the pot bonus. These are companies that make millions of dollars off of say their brands, like Mortal Kombat, has made millions of dollars in the past. So, I mean, a little $10,000 here, $10,000 there for tournaments to keep people interested and buying games, they still make like millions of dollars just making the game. You know, like they make the game. It takes so much time to make the game. Yeah, so you got to pay your studio time and labor and all that stuff. But after that, like, what are you left with? Profit. And to keep people interested, you're going to keep on. And then especially with those, like, everybody buys DLC packs now and, like, $20 a pop and, like, new characters and shit like that. Like it's a legit business. I don't know if it's going to die out. It might die out. Like, the only way it would die out is, like, completely would be, like, if people just completely lost the interest, like, somehow. Or, like, maybe there's, like, a crazy war or something that happens. That's the only way I could see, like, competitive gaming dying out. Like, I mean, this shit's being... It's just as common as, like, baseball or football, you know, like, multi-million dollar. It'll be, like, it's a multi-million dollar industry. Yeah, as far as arcades go, I mean, as far as, like, in a centralized area being any good, I don't know. Freestanding arcades, maybe. As far as the malls go, though, I mean, I don't know. Look at this shit. It's like Street Fighter style, like, yo, blow this fucking, kill this, plane, kill this car. What do I gotta do? What do I gotta do? I got 55 seconds. There we go. Okay. That's the first half. What do I have to do? There we go. Okay, that's enough on that one. This side. That one's enough. 10 seconds. It's not gonna get it. I'm not gonna make it. 3, 2, 1. No. Boo. Boo. Boo this man. Oh, that's gotta be Blarg, I bet. Look at that battle rat. Yeah, it's gotta be. Press jump to activate Super Smash. Oh, I got two of them. That's what those little coin looking things are. Oh, nice. Ow. Yeah, no, I mean, not even gaming, but I mean, as long as there's people running tournaments, like, tournaments themselves, like, get a lot of money, you know, like, what do? You rent out a ballroom, or like eventually it'll be like stadiums and whatnot. But I mean, the bigger tournaments, they have bigger turnouts. Like even people who are doing little turnouts, little tournaments, like those guys are gonna continue to try to grow their tournament scene. So I mean, the guys who've been around doing it for a while, say like Valle and whoever, like Valle in California or like. Whoever, just like, what, I'm not sure who runs in OBC, but like that's run out of an arcade, you know, and yeah, just people growing their scenes and stuff, and the events that are bigger, Mr. Wizard and Vegas and Evo and shit like that, you know, like those guys, they're gonna keep doing what they do. They're not gonna they're not gonna quit, you know. So as long as those guys are running them, and as long as like the video game developers are pouring money into pot bonuses and stuff like that, yeah, I mean, this scene will be around for a while. Shit's been around since the 90s. Oh, oh my gosh. Okay, where's my super? It says jump. There we go. Nice, got him. Almost died there. These guys are dicks. At least I hope it stays around. Yeah, how close are you to Orlando? There's one every summer. I think it's in June. I've actually been to it. It's called CEO, or Community Effort Orlando for short. Or, well, that's what CEO stands for. It's actually wrestling themed. It's really cool. And this past year, they had Xavier Woods and Kenny Omega. You're in Orlando? Well, you missed it. You've been missing it. But yeah, no, look it up. CEO. It's legit. It's a really good tournament. It's one of my favorites. Like, I didn't do that well. I placed 17th when I was out there. Out of 75 or so. But, I mean, I had a lot of fun that weekend. Oh my goodness. What the fuck? Do I have to beat this guy up? Yeah. It was at the Wyndham. What games are there? Street Fighter, like, usually fighting game tournaments, they have, like, Street Fighter, they have, like, any, like, not all fighting game tournaments are gonna have, like, arcade machines brought in, but some of them do, you know, they'll have, like, legit arcade machines from old school days brought in, and then, you'll have your, like, PS3s, your PS4s, your Xbox Ones, your Xbox 360s there and shit. And usually, it just depends on what area and what the interests are at the time. Like, there's been, like, for instance, like, KIT is in Tennessee. That, this year, is gonna have Street Fighter V. Gonna have Tekken. Tekken 7 is gonna be there. Killer Instinct is gonna be there. What else? Probably Skullgirls, Dead or Alive. Basically fighting games people are interested in. Ultimate Marvel vs. Capcom 3. That's usually at most of the events to some degree. Yeah, man, I mean, yeah, there's a big tournament scene, like, there's usually a big tournament every month. The next one is in Florida for, as far as, or not Florida, I'm sorry, New York, or maybe it's Pennsylvania, it's in Pennsylvania, yeah. The next one's in, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Called NEC, Northeast Championships. So there's that one. And then, that's the next big tournament. This Combo Clash that's coming up at San Antonio. It's a big tournament, yeah. But it's only KI, so the tournaments, so the turnout's not going to be anywhere near where, like, say, NEC is. NEC is, like, considered major. Combo Clash is considered a major, but it's considered a KI major. So, like, only KI players are going to be there, you know? Like, no big, big tournament players from other games are going to be there because it's just going to be for KI, you know? So you might see, like, 50 to 75 at Combo Clash San Antonio, or you might see 30 to 40 only. But it's given out a pretty nice amount of World Cup points, so I'm assuming the people who haven't qualified will probably end up showing up. Or people who just want to try to win KI versus Texas. As far as NEC goes, which is also in December, which is around the same time, yeah, that's going to have, like, some big names there. I say big names, like, I don't know. All your Street Fighter guys that are going for Capcom Pro Tour, those guys are going to be there. And then it's going to have some pretty big KI guys there, too. I'm sure Bass will probably be there, maybe Sleep or Rico or something. Who knows? I'm sure that kid, I don't know if you were watching when I played Morbid Hoagie when he destroyed me with Spinal, but he should be there, I'm sure. He lives in that area. Yeah, it's just like, and then like every month there's a tournament, more than like, most of the time anyway. I don't really know of many tournaments in February. But, yeah, as far as January goes, January's KIT, and then February, I'm not sure. March, they usually do final round at Atlanta. April is usually Texas Showdown here in Houston. And then there's, Combo Breaker in Chicago in April, or in May, sorry. June is Florida, CEO. July is the biggest tournament in the world in Vegas, where most of the people from, where most of the international people come to the States. August is Absolute Battle in Dallas. September is usually TFC, or the Fall Classic. Or maybe that's in October, I don't know. October, I'm not sure what's in October either. And that might be the Fall Classic as well, I don't know. Like, Fall Classic is in one of those 3 months. September, October, or one of those 2 months. What was this month? November. I don't know if there was anything this month either. I'm sure there was. There's also international tournaments that I don't know about, like European tournaments. Canada Cup was last month, I think. Yeah, people actually make a living playing these tournaments. There's like Filipino Champ. He's a guy that travels a lot for tournaments. Chris G, like F Champ is from Cali. Chris G from New York. Got players like. You know, a lot of people are sponsors for this shit, and they get paid because they win all the big prize money, and then they do nothing but play video games. Which, I'm not a full-time player, but I do play a lot, so I know a lot of them, and I've traveled a lot because I used to be sponsored. But, yeah, I'm not quite as good as some of those players, or quite as consistent. Like, the highest I've ever placed in a KI tournament was third at a major, anyway. I've won plenty of locals. I've won locals here in Houston. I've won locals in San Antonio. But as far as, like, which also have some of the same tournament players show up, But as far as like a major tournament on like a big stage where like everybody's there from all the other games too and stuff like that, yeah. The biggest I've won, I've gotten close, was third. And online, I've placed second, and I've actually won some online tournaments too, but those are some of the smaller online tournaments, not the bigger ones. The bigger ones, the biggest online tournament I've been in was an 8-bit beatdown, and got second in. Lost to a guy named T-Swag, which is a pretty cool guy. He ended up actually working on the game, but that, not before he beat me. And that match was really close too. So I mean, there's always the possibility of any of these top players that you see like playing, always winning. Sure, other players are more consistent, and it has to do with like frame data and character knowledge and a bunch of other stuff. But you also have to train yourself, or I mean, you can get help from other people. But as far as me goes, I don't really get help from other people. I do it all myself. So, I mean, I do get help from friends around sometimes, around my city, for the most part. And that's just, you know, little advices and matchup. I haven't really, like, made friends with any, like, superstar players to where I'm just, like, you know, stole their training regimen or some shit like that. I don't do that shit. Nah, I'd rather do it on my own. So, I mean, and, like, a couple months ago, I finally decided after 3 years that I was going to try to learn some frame data, and it's actually helped me out. Like, I know when to punish shit, I know when not to punish shit sometimes, but I don't 100% know the numbers. Like, these guys who've been playing for like 3 years, they just go and study those numbers all the time. And then they just go and play in tournaments. And sometimes they play ranked, and sometimes they don't, you know? Like, of course they play ranked, so that way they can stay up to beat with a lot of the competitors. But yeah, like, I mean, yeah, people travel, they make all this money. People get sponsored. The sponsors will pay for your trips and all that kind of stuff. But you have to give them a percentage of the winnings whenever you win. So, I mean, It's pretty cool. And then that's just for fighting games. Like, as far as like League of Legends and shit like that goes, they have a lot more money poured into those games than this. Like StarCraft 2 and League of Legends and stuff. Halo, Call of Duty. Those are games that have way more pop bonuses. Like, players win millions off those games compared to, like, just the 10,000s and 20, 30, 40,000s that they went off of KI or, KI, Street Fighter, stuff like that. Like, I think, Capcom Cup this year is giving $500,000 to the winners. Like, it's kind of ridiculous. So it's like, play video games, be the best, win a lot of money. Don't have to, you don't have to necessarily have a job. That is your job, you know, is playing games. But you have to be that fucking good. Which, I've tried that. And I'm just not as good. You know, I'm decent, but I make bad decisions. Yeah, pretty good at some things, but just haven't quite figured out what I need to do exactly 100% to be on those guys' levels. Which those guys have talked to each other and given each other advice over the years so much that, you know, They don't give out the advice just to anybody. They give out the advice to who they want to. That's fine. That's fine with me. I'm cool with that. like I said, I'm doing it on my own. Dude, at this point, I think I probably put at least 10 bucks into this arcade machine if I was playing at the arcade. Maybe even 15. Yeah, it usually costs you about 20 bucks to beat a game at the arcades. I knew it. I fucking knew it. You remember the boss I played at Surf City? Yeah, this is him. Big bad Blarg. Jeez. Pick. And there he goes. Stomping time. That's great. Oh, he's back down. Back down to small. Yeah, bosses were made to eat your quarters too. So you're supposed to die on bosses. Like if you go through a boss without dying at all, it's because somebody else is. It's because you're back here in the corner while like you're playing multiplayer and somebody else is up there fucking getting destroyed and yeah, that's some real ass arcade talk, man. Like, and the beautiful thing about it is, like, it's different for everybody, right? Like, everybody has their own personal experiences, like, that actually used to play in arcades and shit. And then, like, you know, there was also the times when you couldn't go to the arcade, so, yeah, you played local multiplayer and shit like that. It's free, like, but it was never the same, like, oh, it's over, he's dead. That's not the final boss, I'm sure, though. Okay, look at this foreground. It looks like you can, like, fall down into it, but no. Get out of here. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. /371. 86 this level. Collector of corpses. Hold button to fire, release button to move left and right. Okay, word. Yeah, this level's legit. Contra style. Oh, I have a, those tokens mean I have like a super move. That's also a staple in, say, rail shooters and bullet hell style games. Oh, wow. Oh, I still got it, though. Nice. Power-ups. See, fire. I actually should have missed that one, because I don't like this power-up. Or it doesn't seem like I do. Yeah, triple. This one's legit, though. Blah blah blah. Yeah, when when players aren't, like, you know, sponsored and whatnot, they also get support from Twitch viewers and shit like that. Me, not as much, to be honest. Like, I was whenever, I guess, Season 2 and stuff like that, which people donate to me every once in a while still, but it's not like, say, it's not to the point where I have, like, 50 to 100 to like 200 viewers at one time. Most of the time, it's usually just like I've done it before. I've pulled up to like 100, but most of the time I don't, like, I don't have a subscribe button, nothing like that. Like say LCD or Paul B or Rico or any of those guys. Those guys have subscribe buttons, so people like pay them $5 a month so they can use their emotes and shit like that. I'm not up to that point yet, but that also, you know. Which those people, some of those people still, you know, have jobs alongside of streaming with Twitch. Because, like, say you get, like, 50 subscribers a month. $5 a piece per month. Let's just, in theory, you say that. That's, like, $500, right? Just about 50 times 5. What is that? That's only $250. That's $250 a month for 50 people paying you $5 a month. So, I mean, depending on, I guess, who it is, what content they stream, how often they stream, if they have a sub button, shit like that. There's a lot of stuff, like, in order to make a living off of it. Unless you just, like, are that good, you know? And also, most of the people that are just that good have way better equipment than I do. Like, they have a sick-ass computer that's capable of, like, streaming whatever they want. Which, technically, I can stream pretty much whatever I want. But it won't be, like, the best quality. Like, this is a pretty good quality right here. But it's also kind of ghetto because it's, like, straight from the console. But, I mean, so I can't have any, like, special widgets or borders or anything like that without sacrificing some quality. Because this laptop that I have my chat on, I can stream on that, but I can only stream 320p instead of, I think this console does 720p. So streaming off of that, that's a thing. But for things that don't matter, like, yeah, I get to have the widgets and shit like that, but also other people, like, production goes into it too, you know? Like, you have, like, people have green screens and, like, pop filters, what they call pop filters, like, for microphones to make sure, like, you know, some of the bad quality stuff doesn't go through. Me, I don't have all that, so you get the raw, uncut shit. Contra was my shit, believe it or not. Actually used to play through it. My mom, I think I was the third one. That's legit. Yeah, I mean, like old school games, like, how does anybody get started, you know? Like it's usually with family. Like, I think I was at my aunt's house the first time I ever played a video game. My mom was there, my dad was there, which my dad never played video games, but it was me, my aunt, my cousin, or me, my mom, my aunt, my cousin, I think my uncle, too. We were all taking turns on Mario. The original fucking Mario is the first game I played, like, so generic, right? Alright! But, yeah, and then after that, started to get to build my own collection with birthdays and Christmases and stuff like that. started on NES, went to SNES, went to fucking Sega. And I've got about 90% of my, or maybe like, I'll say 85% of my collection still. And in working order. Well, if you want to say in working order, it'd be about 80%. Because my N64, I need to repair my N64, and I just so happened to sell my Dreamcast like a fucking idiot because I wanted an original Xbox like that damn bad. So I went ahead and sold my Dreamcast, I sold my PS1, I sold most of my PS1 games. Like, I have 2 PS1 games left. And I think I kept like Final Fantasy 7 and 8. And I kept SmackDown, and I actually lost 7 and 8 somewhere. So the only game I have in my PS1 collection is SmackDown, WWE SmackDown, because it was such a good game. It really was a good game. The original one was really good, but. Yeah, there's that. But I have obtained, like, a lot of games that I sold via emulators and stuff like that. So, I mean, it's almost like I don't know. Except for the Dreamcast stuff. I don't have any of the Dreamcast stuff back. Kind of sucks, but oh well. All right. It's too legit. All up in my face. So I guess I can say keeping my games, most of them. Has kind of done good, you know. Like, a lot of people, I hear a lot of gamers that have, like, today's game consoles and stuff like that. They're all like, and I used to have that and shit like that. And I'm thinking, like, yo, I'm glad I never got rid of most of this. Like, it upsets me that I didn't have the money to to buy the original Xbox. And I thought, like, I would never get one, you know. And I really didn't want to wait no longer. For some reason. I let my friend talk me into fucking selling my Dreamcast, because he was really big into fucking trading games for the newest shit all the time. Me, on the other hand, I was into keeping my shit while getting new shit. And yeah, it paid off for me in the long run, but then again, there was some, like, say, classics I missed. I didn't get the original Halo. I barely got Halo 2, and it wasn't, like, in launch. It was actually, like, maybe a year and a half after that shit came out or so. Condition Crick, Shield 23. 8%. Yeah, this is about dead. But, yeah, I mean, it's. I feel blessed that I have, like, most of my collection. It's legit. Like, same friend I'm talking about, even today, he's like, yo, I don't have a PS3 anymore, so I can't play so-and-so game with you. I'm sorry. Like, yo, I'm like, he lives in Cali now, and I live here in Texas, and I'm like, yo, let's play some games. And most of the games we could play, he doesn't have, you know? Like, I still have them, but he doesn't. But but that's his business. And I mean, I get it, you know, like, yeah, look at this shit. That's funny. Like the dialogue box. Okay. Yeah, even like today, you know, he was like, all he has is PS4 games, pretty much, and I think it's like, well, fuck, man, if you would've kept some of your shit, then, like, we could play shit together. But then again, if he wants to play it that bad, he can just go out and get it. And at the same time, like, I can see, like, not wanting this collection of games just sitting around, you know, like sometimes I look up at it, and I'm like, well, like, I hardly ever play a lot of these, but then again, there are, like, times where I'm, like, I just go through all of them, and I'm just like, yo, I want to fucking play this game right now, and I can't. I never got to, yeah, I missed out on the GameCube, too, unfortunately. I've never owned one. I really wanted one, but, hey, I mean, you have to make choices and sacrifices in order to, you know, continue to play stuff. Or, so, I mean, I have the original Smash, and I still have it, but as far as GameCube go and Melee, I had to go play at a friend's house and stuff like that. $895 fucking enemies just killed. And I unlocked the achievement of beating the game. The Master of Mayhem. Bad guys never seem to be to go quietly. You know what sucks though about this Rare Replay? You can't like bring the screen out full so you get the full experience. You can put this on there, which is pretty cool. So you can just click that, and then like that's like that. But like, as far as the borders go, I mean, yeah, they're cool, but like, I enjoy, say, on Third Strike Online Edition, you can just take the borders off and like make it full screen. I'm pretty sure there's probably a way you could do it here. The borders do look cool though. Totally awesome. Yo, that's crazy because I put that as my stream title earlier when I was practicing the original Toads, and it says it there. Took me an hour to beat that. So we'll do Rash and Pimple on another stream some other time. Kevin Bayless. I follow that guy on Twitter. Yeah, he does a lot of rares, artwork and shit. It's crazy, like, I never thought, like, whenever I got older, I would, like, know who these people are by name, you know, that make the games and shit like that. Like, or at least recognize them and, like, be able to put a name to the face. Never thought that. I've actually met some developers and shit like that. I haven't met Kevin Bayless, but I've met, like, say, James Goddard and who else? Shit, man. Oh, Keats and shit like that. Like, people with the new game. I used to put my initials in there, but, since new school days, anytime I play, I just put CB now. It's 1 hour. I got most kills though. I didn't get the fastest time. I'll do CB with like either a period or exclamation point or some shit like that. That's my new tag. So if you see CBs anywhere in the arcades, it's usually me, hopefully. Well, that was fun. That's Battletoads Arcade. So there's Pimple. Wow. Looks legit, yo. The fucking graphics are great. Well, it's been fun, guys. Yeah, it's 6 a.m. I'm gonna go ahead and probably crash out, man. Let's see. Let's go back. I know Talon how many quarters I used. 2 out of 5 milestones. Spectator 3. You unlocked a new video. Would you like to go there? Yes. Let's go watch that first before we leave. The making of. Making of what? Is it Battletoads? No. Dreaming of Banjo. The making of Banjo. Collect more stamps and reach rank 4 to unlock this video. Boo. That would have been so much better if I got to watch this video on the stream. I mean, I guess I could watch this. Banjo, since I did unlock it.
After we've done two kind of platforms.
Yeah, it was fun hanging out, man. Happy Thanksgiving. Yeah, happy Thanksgiving to you too, man. Probably going to close out the stream after this. I'll just be quiet so y'all can watch.
Let's do our take on an adventure game.
When I joined Dream, we just started to move it to N64. It previously been started on SNES, but we were looking to move it onto this.
I think I've already seen this on YouTube.
It looked very nice, but this was like really at the end of the Super NES's life.
We had Edson, which was the hero of the game, and we had Dinger, which was his kind of pet dog that he finds. And he'd say,
"Oh, dog, I can see a dog down there. I'm gonna go and see if he's all right."
You'd go down, you'd get the dog, and then you'd be chased by trolls. And we worked on that for a number of months.
I never did own any of the Banjo games, but I'm gonna end up playing them. Especially now that I own them all in this collection. Yeah, I'm playing that shit one day. And Bad Fur Day too. Aw, man. It's legit.
I think the scope of the thing was so large, we couldn't see any end in sight.
Greg and Tim have been talking and decided to change the whole styling of the game, and it became something akin to Super Mario 64.
We'd changed the main character from the boy, who we felt was a bit weak, and we felt we wanted something a bit more character. So we investigated firstly a rabbit, and then secondly a bear.
All right, Lama, take it easy, man. I'll see you next time.
Let's get a banana in there. Bear, rabbit, a bear. That was it.
It went from being Dream to being Kazoo, but again, it was jumping on things. Lots of kind of baddies and different things you could be doing.
And it's all going to be instruments. Banjo, piccolo, blues, all of those. Yes, I'll just do it right now.
So we had kind of Banjo in this kind of big, sprawling adventure game that we weren't quite sure how we were ever going to finish. So we decided to can Dream at that point and focus on something we felt a lot more confident we could kind of build.
And I remember talking with Chris Stamper in the canteen, and asking me what I thought of Banjo. I think I was a little bit annoyed that the rabbit had been dumped.
We took Banjo from Project Dream and kind of put him in his own game, and we wanted him to be a platformer.
Should have been a rabbit. It would have been Bunny Kazooie or something.
The roaming world of Banjo, we encountered a whole new set of problems because we were working in 3D.
So we started developing like a move for Banjo, and I wanted to give him a double jump, having kind of seen Mario's double jump, but I wanted it to be more flexible so the player could double jump anywhere they like.
We're up against Mario,
we
wanted to try and beat
Mario, and obviously, you know, try to do that. So what would that mean, the fact that this jump in midair? So I think we pondered a few ideas, and when we're getting desperate, and usually when you get desperate, all the crazy ideas come out, and one idea we had was a pair of wings could appear out of his backpack.
All these two things that we just encountered as we started developing, we kind of just tackled them out.
This pair of wings kind of came out of the backpack and flapped, and it explained it away, and it fitted perfectly.
We started testing out proper sort of 3D levels, and we got, you know, the character jumping around and swimming and things, and it then went from Kazoo to Banjo Kazoo.
well, let's have a pair of legs that appear out the backpack to kind of assist Banjo, so it's not him running, it's the these legs.
So we then added EI on the end, or IE rather, and it became Banjo-Kazooie, and then we just made that.
These wings and these legs could belong to another character, and this character lives in Banjo's backpack and comes out at occasions to help him along, so that was where Kazooie was born. It was probably the breakthrough moment, and then all the dialogue, the interjection between them, and Kazooie being sarcastic and adventurous, and Banjo being like kind of a bit dim-witted and slow. All of that was kind of came afterwards, and it was all literally just built on this wanting a double jump.
We needed like a shaman character, and then it was really just down. You know, we were just left to do, you know, get on with it. So Mumbo quickly took shape with his skull and his feathers and his furry pants, and in those days, you could literally draw the character, get someone to approve it, model it, animate it, and have it in the game. It was, you know, 2 or 3 days.
So Banjo and Kazooie never speak, but initially they did. I think one of the reasons we made them have that strange garbled noise. We realised we were going to have to record so much speech, it was going to increase development time considerably.
I did the voice of Mumbo, of course, Ikum Bokum.
The voices for all the characters were just kind of different. A lot of them were Grant, but a lot of them were different people just kind of mumbling sort of different little phrases.
The Ikum Bokum, I just played with it and it sounded good. So Ikum Bokum is made up of come and have a go if you think you're hard enough. So like I went, God, what, I bought this got up like that, and I like, recorded myself doing that, and then I cut it up into pieces.
When you've been working on Dream, great. I can go from the voice for the boy, and then when you change to the bear, Tim was looking for a noise. There are noises that he would make and words that he would say. So I did some of the voices for Banjo then, and then it transformed into the gargled noise at the end. So the Kazooie needed a special noise as well. It needed to be separate from Banjo. It needed to be noticeably different. So we made her a much sharper noise because she was a Breagle. So that was why she was... Stop and Swap, that came about because we discovered by accident that if you pull out the cartridge on the N64, put in another cartridge, the contents of the memory, the RAM, are still there. So we realised that we could use this to make a transfer of some information from one game to another.
The idea was to have to either reward players for playing rare games, so it's like the more you play, the more you get rewarded, or to actually swap items between games, and that's where the Stop and Swap came from. And so you have to like quickly grab the cartridge, grab it, and then put the other one in. And I think we were concerned that people were going to do damage to their cartridges.
Unfortunately, we didn't tell Nintendo, because we didn't think they'd really need to know until towards the end. And then, of course, when we did tell them, they said, that's not really going to work, and it's not guaranteed to work in all cases for the N64. So as a result, we had to drop the feature, but the remnants of that still exist in both games.
Legit.
The game, I think, was well received. Again, another massive thing for me was to see Banjo at the top of the all formats charts in the UK.
Above Tekken 3? Nah.
The humour and the charm and the characters we managed to put into the world.
When I see my son play Banjo-Kazooie, it's really heartwarming because it just feels right.
It felt like almost every character you came across had a story to tell. Most of them were sob stories that you had to help out. So it was almost like Banjo was like an agony aunt going around fixing all these problems. So
like running around in Banjo was fun without doing anything. It was just fun to run around, you know.
I think they loved it, didn't they? What are you saying?
Had that all that magic about it. You could feel it. It was in the wall.
I think it was just like the whole immersive nature.
Oh crap, my bad. My bad, guys.
The charm of it was what elevated it from maybe just another 3D platform into something that kind of people remember.
Tight. Well, yeah, see, that's pretty cool. So yeah, if you guys didn't know, Rare is like a UK studio. That's cool. But yeah. Thanks for watching, guys. Chillin'. Played some KI, played some Battletoads, the NES game, and the arcade game.
I'll be back probably later today sometime, so y'all can come watch me play some more KI or whatever, maybe play this some more. Yeah. All right, guys. Thanks for watching. Peace out.